Good day. Welcome to this blockchain webinar organized by Exyn. Today I'm with Jolien van der Zwan. Jolien is an innovation lead for Société Netherlands and responsible for blockchain with the company. She has a diverse background in media, retail, healthcare, aviation and banking industries. She provides customers with insights and advice on innovation and new technologies related to their strategy. Jolien is responsible for the Dutch chapter of Society Labs, the international community of thought leaders. My name is Simone van Zuylen. I'm a global marketeer at Exyn, and I will be your host today. The webinar today will be about blockchain. It seems to be the answer to every problem at the moment. But how is it applied in business, and why would this be a good idea? At the end of this webinar, you will have a clear understanding of the application of blockchain technology in business, and be able to understand it in a more general global trends. Note you're all on mute. You can ask questions during the webinar with the chat function. We will answer the questions during the webinar and at the end. The webinar will be recorded and you will receive an email with the recording link at the end of this week. Enjoy the webinar and over to you, Jolien. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Simone. I'm happy to be here. I will start my story with explaining how blockchain is applied. I will do that on two levels of complexity. I will not explain in detail how blockchain works because I think it's more important to understand how it's applied and how it's applied in a business context. For example, I don't fully understand how TCP/IP works, but I do know what you can do with the internet. So that's the aim for today. After this explanation, I will talk about a couple of trends that we see happening in society and how blockchain provides solutions that are answers to these trends. Also, I will go more in detail on a couple of very innovative examples that go towards these trends and talk some about how to start using blockchain in a business context. What are the main challenges, and in specific, how to deal with test and quality in a blockchain project. So I'll first start with the 1-minute pitch on blockchain. A couple of years ago, when I started talking about blockchain, there was a lot less general understanding about what it was exactly. So people had heard of Bitcoin, for example, but what are we talking about? And in essence, conceptually, it's not very difficult. What you can do with blockchain is make a digital asset unique. And that's very new. That's actually revolutionary. Because in the physical world, you can always, it's very normal that you can have a unique object and exchange its ownership. For example, if I have a 10-euro bill, I can give it to someone that's sitting next to me and they can be sure that I didn't keep a copy or give a copy away to someone else. In the digital world, we've never been able to do that. That's why we have different business models in the digital world, service models, for example, but also industries like the movie industry and music industry have had a lot of trouble because you can endlessly copy a digital asset. And this is what blockchain solves. So with blockchain, you can make a digital asset unique, safely change ownership, and also automate the conditions for the exchange of this ownership. So if certain conditions are met, the transfer or the transaction is being done. So that's the level one explanation. I think this is a very nice example of how this can work. It's a Dutch startup called Guts, and they made a blockchain application for concert tickets. Concert tickets, there was a lot of fraud with them. So people would sell the same digital ticket 30 or 40 times on the internet, and only the first person who bought this ticket could get into the concert. And someone would have made a lot of money on the expense of others. Also, if tickets would become scarce, for a short period before a very popular concert, for example, people would ask astronomical amounts of money for one ticket. So what Guts did is make this digital concert ticket unique and make it possible for you to safely transfer ownership, so you can sell it second hand, so to speak, but only for the original price that the ticket was sold for. So with smart contracts, they automated the condition that you can only resell it for the original price. They now have three or four artists that they sell the concert tickets for, and also in cabaret, for example, Jochem Meyer. Then if we look one level deeper into how does blockchain work exactly, we come to how is wealth generated. It's generated by the flow of goods and services across business networks. For that, you need connectivity. So in this picture, it's a Thai market in fruit and vegetables. The connectivity is by just moving along your boat and going somewhere else. But these markets are central to the generation of wealth and the flow of goods in the economy. There's public markets like this one, but also private markets in private equity, for example. And assets can be tangible, like fruit and vegetables, but also intangible, like most money at the moment, or any other digital asset, like the digital concert tickets we just saw. In this process, ledgers are crucial. They facilitate the exchange of goods and the flow of goods between different parties. Transactions are stored in ledgers, together with who owns it. So if there's a change in ownership, the ledger is updated on both sides, but maybe also on the side of a bank or a regulator. So this can become quite a complicated process of bookkeeping of ownership of the asset. So what if you could share one version of the truth and have one digital ledger that's replicated among all participants that contains all the assets, their owner, and records the transactions between them. So now you all share the same vision of the truth and you would never have to exchange data in any other way. And there cannot be any disputes among the participants because there can be no differences between the ledgers they keep. And this is what blockchain can do for business. So a very well-known example here is IBM and Maersk. Maersk ships flowers from Kenya to the Netherlands. A lot of people think that flowers are produced in the Netherlands and then shipped to the rest of the world, but it's not fully true. We're a flower hub. So flowers go to Amsterdam, to Schiphol, from all over the world and from the Netherlands, and then ship to other places. But in this trade lane from Kenya to the Netherlands with flowers, they counted 200 different paper documents that have to go along with one shipment of flowers. So all these papers have to be made up, but also all along the way, there's officials, customs officials, for example, that have to sign off, check, and control this document flow. This is also a cause of errors because it's human work, and once in a while you will just make a mistake. This may mean that the shipment cannot go through, but it could also mean that this ship cannot leave port for a while, and that costs a lot of money. So what they did is they made a proof of concept in which all the parties along this trade lane share one digital ledger that contains all information on the shipment of flowers. And in this system, they could also do their approvals, checks and controls in a digital way. That means that there's a lot less controls needed, a lot less manual work, so it saves a lot of time. And the entire process is digitized, so you can also analyze the data. So that's the core of the value that blockchain solutions can bring for business. It reduces risk, saves time, saves cost, and increases trust. And increased trust means that you need a lot less controls, checks, and balances. Another good example, also quite different example, is a customer of Société. It's a big aerospace industry player. In aerospace, there's a lot of rules and regulations for parts. So for one helicopter, you have to keep track of 400 different parts, who produced them and who serviced them. They have a system for that now that's based on paper cards. So with 13,000 helicopters in service that need tracking for 400 parts each, and there's a lot of administration. So in practice, it works like a mechanic replaces a part in a helicopter, then walks back to his desk, writes on the paper card his name, the time, and what he did to the part or the part he replaced. But that's not the biggest problem, this inefficiency, because if there's a fault in production and this part is already integrated in some of the helicopters, they will have to go through 13,000 times 400 paper cards to find out what helicopters have to be kept on the ground because the part is faulty and they have the serial number for this part in them. So what we did is build a proof of concept with blockchain technology that can track all these parts throughout their lifetime. Because once in blockchain data is stored, it's immutable and you can always trace back the full sequence of transactions. You can always see back what happened to this specific part, but also because it's digitized, the data is there. You can analyze on it, and also you can see in a couple of seconds for one serial number of parts from a faulty production, for example, what helicopters it went through. So this can bring a lot for companies like these. Also, it's in most cases and most parts, this is a proof of concept in experimental stages. And I think that's still the phase we are in. According to Gartner, you may know the Gartner hype cycle. We are just past the biggest hype, but there's still a bit of hype in there. To show that it's becoming more serious, in this movie you can see the amount of money that was raised through ICOs, initial coin offerings. That's a way of raising money for blockchain solutions. That's like or an alternative to an IPO. Last year in 2017, $5.6 billion was invested in ICOs. And in the first 3 months of 2018, $3.3 billion was raised. And that's a lot more than last year if you compare it. Also, the number of investments is decreasing, so more money per investment is made. And I think that shows something that we're moving towards more serious stages. Now the question is, how come and why does blockchain seem to be relevant at this time? What you see here is the headlines of the research by Edelman. Edelman writes a report each year on trust in the world. And they look at a couple of aspects, but they always have a headline. Last year, 2017, it was trust in crisis and meltdown. And this year it's the battle for truth. So that's the battle for truth, I think, gives hope again. So where are we moving now? Some details about 2018 is that trust in media are at all-time low. We have fake news, for example, and trust in technology is higher, also in experts, generally in people, but much less so in institutions. If you look at this picture, these are Rachel Bodman's three ways of organizing trust. We used to have a lot of trust in brands and institutions, and this is at an all-time low at the moment. We've had the rise of platform trust, so Airbnb and Uber, but they are showing cracks in the trust already as well. And on the right side, you see trust as a protocol. And this is really what's happening. If you look at Edelman, and part of the research result was that trust in technology is at all-time low, and also trust in people much more, or individuals much more than in institutions. So if you look back at the first explanation about what you can do with blockchain. You can exchange something of value one-on-one. All you need for it is technology, and there's high trust in technology. You don't need a platform and you don't need an institution. And there's a lot more trust in the person on the other side. So that seems why this is really relevant right now. Other things we see as trends, next to the disruption of reality, the fake news. So what can you believe is true anymore? Is the loss of control. And the loss of control comes with the big companies owning your data. So big companies like Facebook and Amazon, they collect all your data and do what they like. And you think you have free services, but they're not really free because you give them your data and that's what they make money out of. Another one is the manipulation of behavior. By having all these data and selling it to each other, these big companies can influence your behavior. I think a good example is that 50% of all Americans believe that the outcomes of the elections with President Trump were influenced by social media and were manipulated on purpose. This is Mr. Don Tapscott. In 2016, he wrote a very good book about blockchain together with his son. Don Tapscott is an authority on the subject of the impact of IT on economy and society. And in this book in 2016, he wrote that blockchain is so fundamentally different conceptually from what we already know that its best applications are yet to come. And we're now 2 years on from there. And I'm wondering if what we see happening now are these better applications that he already spotted. So this is just a short video to illustrate fake news and how easy it is and how accessible the technology is for everyone in order to manipulate news and videos just for anyone. So it's not technically difficult to produce fake news, and that's really a risk for what we can and cannot believe anymore.
We're entering an era in which our enemies can make it look like anyone is saying anything at any point in time, even if they would never say those things. So, for instance, they could have me say things like, I don't know, Killmonger was right, or Ben Carson is in the sunken place, or how about this, simply, President Trump is a total and complete dipshit. Now, you see, I would never say these things, at least not in a public address, but someone else would, someone like Jordan Peele. This is a dangerous time. Moving forward, we need to be more vigilant with what we trust from the internet. That's a time when we need to rely on trusted news sources. It may sound basic, but how we move forward in the age of information is going to be the difference between whether we survive or whether we become some kind of fucked up dystopia. Thank you. Stay woke, bitches.
So if this is what you can have President Obama say, that's quite a risk because he intended this movie just to make us aware of what you can do, but someone with bad intentions can do something completely different. And that's also why the American Homeland Security joined forces with a company called Factum. They make software that can hash files to a blockchain in order to always be able to trace back its authenticity. What happens with hashing is that you take a file and encrypt it one way, to form a hash, and the hash is just a string of digits, a unique string of digits. If you hash the exact same file again with the same key, you get the same hash, the same string of digits. But if you change even the smallest thing, the hash that comes out of it is completely different. Now, if you store this hash in a blockchain, it's immutable and you store it with a timestamp. That means that if in future you encrypt this same file to a hash and compare it to what's on the blockchain, you can always prove that it already existed at that date and time in this exact same form, thus proving the authenticity of a file. So that's a way of being able to combat fake news. Then in the data space, what we see happening in the internet, where there were once dreams of a decentralized open network, it developed into a place of centralist strongholds. So these big companies, Google, Amazon, Facebook, but also the Asian Alibaba and Tencent, they cleverly use network effects to create winner-takes-all markets. They grow exponentially, use our data to capitalize, and also are going the way of monopolies. So that can be quite a danger. But then there's alternatives for this rising up, and these alternatives often are blockchain companies. So for YouTube, there's an alternative called DTube. DTube does not earn money by collecting your data or showing you advertisements, but through viewer donations. So there's a very direct business model. Again, you just pay for what you view. Same goes for Steemit. It's built on the same platform as DTube. It's a social network where the content creators are dependent on the favors of the users. So the users just pay for the content that they like. For Google, there's an alternative called Bitclave. It has a search engine called DSearch. You can use it right now. It's built on the same principles. And same goes for Bee, the Airbnb alternative. Bee is similar in ease of use as Airbnb. It just doesn't have the aggregating company, so it doesn't have the platform in between. It's just you as a user doing business with another user directly. No service fees in between. And the way the model works is they give out the Bee token, and by improving the platforms by the users themselves, they raise the value of the Bee token, meaning that when they invest in furthering their own platform, they also invest in the Bee tokens they own themselves. Then in the sovereignty space and the identity, we see self-sovereign identity coming up. So it's actually pretty strange that to prove who you are, you have to have a paper document that's given out by an institution, that's the government. Why isn't this digital? And also, why do you always have to show everything that's on there? So a good example is if you want to buy alcohol at the supermarket and prove that you're over 18, why do you have to show your entire passport and cannot just show that you are over 18? And there's an institution that's authorized that has verified that you are over 18. So the principle of self-sovereign identity is for you to be the owner of your own data and the own data about your own identity, and only giving away or showing or letting others use what you decide that they use. Another interesting example here is iPay, that was devised by United Nations for Syrian refugees. In these refugee camps, there are a lot of people that didn't have identity documents, and they had to find a good way to distribute the food among them. So what they do is let these people pay by iris scan. So the scan of their iris is connected to a digital identity that's connected to a ledger that contains tokens for which they can buy food at the local distributing points for food. So this way you can be sure that there's no fraud and everybody gets what they are entitled to. This is a nice quote, I think, because all of these innovative solutions or examples that we just saw are by new companies, and a lot of them are lookalikes of existing solutions, but have different principles below them, and those connect to the three trends that we saw. The fake news, loss of control and a monopoly power, and the manipulation of behavior. So if you turn these around to what's the positive terminology, they are new versions of existing models, but they're based on truthfulness, equality, and sovereignty. This is a quote by Richie Etwaru. He wrote quite an interesting book on blockchain recently, and he says all organizations can be disrupted by more trusted versions of themselves. So it's trust by design, really. So if we look at where to start as a business, if you think that blockchain could be relevant for you or maybe a threat, but if you want to know how to get started, I think most important is to gain insight on the strategic side, because blockchain is about exchanging value between multiple parties. It's never really a good idea in any use case for a back office solution, for example. So you should always cooperate with multiple parties. And then how do you start? Do you start with three or four parties? So you can make fast progress, for example, or be easier on the decision making? Or do you want to start with 20 or 30 so that you have larger scale and maybe move faster from the budget side, but also have to keep into account that you also have 20 or 30 sets of security rules and sets of lawyers who have opinions about what you're doing there. It will impact your business model quite easy, especially because it's about exchange of value and about multiple parties. But it's still a good idea to, after this big thinking, start small with an experiment and find a use case that can deliver value fast. Because doing, I think, is the best way of learning. And alongside this, the bigger research can be done, but that's specified to the topic that the use case is all about. But there are some challenges. I'm a diver. This picture on the left I made myself. It's a very beautiful ecosystem in Batu Bulung, Indonesia. It has a lot of mature corals, hard and soft corals, and lots of different species of fish, and they all depend on each other. And this is exactly one of the challenges in the blockchain space. The ecosystem is still building. It's not quite mature yet. You can compare it to being the only one having internet. There's not much that you can do with it. It needs a certain amount of scale. So there will be slow growth and then a tipping point where the ecosystem is mature enough to really get the value out of it that you would want. Another one is the mindset. It requires a different way of thinking to do business and to work in an economy without third parties. So this also still has to grow and is also a cultural thing. But also very practical things like data quality.
Jolie, data quality there's a question coming in. Just a quick question. Hey, you mentioned in the slide before it's kind of overall overarching implementation. But which team should take the lead when this will be implemented in the organization? What is your suggestion?
Well, I think it's always a good idea to have an actual business owner. So IT should be highly involved, and probably also if there's an innovation department, the innovation department, because they can advise on how to do it. But there should be someone who has the actual stake in it. So the one that's going to be the beneficiary, who's going to receive the value from it. And I think also the leader in the project should be coming from this side, so business side. Does that answer your question?
Yes, they say thank you.
Okay, thank you. Good. So on this data quality issue, it's a very old principle that if you put in garbage, you will get it out. But in blockchain, if you put it in, it never goes out again because it's immutable. So it will always be there. That means that you have to have a very good test and quality strategy and very high standards. And also in security, that's a very important subject because usually we're talking about the exchange of value in blockchain solutions, meaning that it has to be very well secured. So a chief security officer should be well aware of the opportunities and risks and how to deal with them. On the one side, there's the technical platforms that are still developing quite rapidly. Most of them are open source, meaning that the community will address the weak spots and they will develop quite quick, usually quicker than non-open source solutions. But on the implementation side, for security, it's, for example, very important how many nodes you are making in an implementation. And given a certain consensus model, there should be enough scale for it to become a fully secure environment. Then, of course, there's the question, should you have a private or a public blockchain? But also, how will performance be? If you intend to scale to 100 or 200 nodes, what will performance be like then? Maybe it works with 5 or 6, but how will it be if you scale this up to a lot? And that's also a topic in testing. But then in testing, some things will always be the same because a blockchain solution is in one side, not unlike any other software solution. It consists of multiple technical elements. So the picture on the left-hand side, it has not only the blockchain and smart contracts, that's the DLT in the picture, but probably also a database, an API for exchange of data with the front end, and user interfaces in the website or in an app. This means that you're testing a whole solution, not only the blockchain and smart contract part. So we don't start with it in any other way than any testing of another project. We start with a PRA, that's a product risk assessment workshop, where we invite the main stakeholders to come up with the most important risks and then devise a risk a testing strategy to that. But then there's a couple of things that are special. The immutability, for example. So it's very important that what's stored on the blockchain is right the first time. That means that you have to have a very high test and quality standards to a blockchain solution because you don't really get a second chance. It also means that it could limit your agile way of working. It's harder to come up with small iterations in an environment that has to be right the first time. So you may have to revert to some more old-fashioned practices of working. Another one is a standard for the quality of a smart contract. So it's a good idea to have basic quality standards for smart contracts to ensure that you don't make any common mistakes in them, really. But there's still also challenges there. So, for example, it's about the exchange of value, and you want a lawyer to validate the smart contract. How does this work? Because it's made in code and you have translation mechanisms for code to natural language, but then you should also fully understand what's happening in there before they could give their approval. More practical one is test environments. It's important to have a blockchain explorer, so you have a direct or direct as possible view on the raw data on the blockchain. So for testing, you are sure that there's not too many other layers in between. So the picture in the previous slide with the complete solution, you want to also unit test separately the API layer and the interface layer, and look directly what's happening in the blockchain, but also find a balance between the setup of a test environment and what the production environment will be. And that can be quite difficult. For example, in an environment that has 50 nodes, would you want to spin up a test environment that has 50 nodes as well? And how are you going to test this across organizations? Or what's the minimum setup that you could use that would produce the good quality test results still? Another good way of helping this quality of testing is to use test automation, because through test automation, you can have very much higher testing volumes or volumes of test cases than by manual testing. So it's very important to have a view on that and to make sure that you use test automation well from the start, really. So testing is one of Société's big expertises. We're already quite good, I think, in the blockchain test and quality area. Also, this is still a space that's developing, so we're also still developing our blockchain testing strategies and our research in this area. So we do a lot more research, and mostly in the newest areas, so societal trends and technology. This is done by FINT, our research institute that's part of Société Labs. Société Labs is our international community of thought leaders, so it contains the top 1% of our consultants. In 2013, we wrote the report on the left. That was an introduction into blockchain technology and how it's applied. The report on the right contains a lot more in-depth information on the topics I talked about in this webinar. It's called In Code We Trust, and it will appear on September 27th. Can be found for free and digital on labs.society.com.
All right, so this is the end of your webinar, isn't it?
Yeah, thanks.
Yeah, so this is, thank you so much, Jolien, for the great content. We've got a few questions that are coming in. You mentioned already a little bit about the security side of blockchain. There is a question coming in, it's really broad, but would hackers be able to break into blockchain and access the data? This seems to be a threat, that's clear, but can you say something about that?
Well, that depends on the application. So it depends on the setup and the design. So in that way, it's not unlike any other application that does not contain blockchain. I think what's important that, for example, Bitcoin exists for 11 years now, has never been hacked itself. Only the surrounding systems like wallets and exchanges and smart contracts have been hacked. And that is by design. So blockchain itself has a very great design in order to prevent hacking. That's important, but because it will always, especially in enterprise context, it will always need systems around it, like I before mentioned, the APIs, database, and user interfaces. It's very important to look at the security of those very well, and especially because it's not just about something, but it's about the exchange of value that you're going to use this application for. One thing that's coming is quantum technology, and quantum computing will be a threat for cryptography. So that will be a security threat for many other things, but blockchain on the technical side is based for a large part on cryptography. So that will be a threat, but that's not very mature yet. And also all builders of technical blockchain platforms know this. So they're already developing and working on how to oppose this threat that quantum computing could bring. Does that answer your question?
I'll just double check. I see a yes, thank you. So that does.
Okay, great.
Okay, great. There's another question, and that is really coming down to students. How can they benefit from blockchain and maybe start learning already a bit more about blockchain? Do you have an answer for that?
What kind of depends on what they want to learn. So if you want to learn about business applications and about how it relates to trends, then you could read these two reports. Also on the website labs.soyst.com, there is a couple of blogs about blockchain. And if you want to learn more on the technical side, then there's online courses, for example. There's a couple of great YouTube videos explaining how blockchain works more in depth. There is actually at the TU Delft a master's study in blockchain. And there's one at the University of Nicosia in Italy, and I think you can follow that online. Also on Coursera platform, there's a MOOC, a massive online open course on blockchain and cryptocurrencies. So that's just a couple of pointers.
Okay, great. Thank you. Then there is another question that is more related to the certifications. I'll ask that question to Suzanne Galletly, who's here with me. Suzanne is the director of the Exyn portfolio. The question is, what's the status on certification of professionals, similar to things happened with security, Scrum, and Verism?
Yeah, so thanks for that. I can take that one. I'd like to take it perhaps in a slightly broader perspective, in the sense of the link between Exyn and blockchain and why we organize this webinar in the first place. Obviously, from an Exyn perspective, our interest in blockchain is due to the implications that it may have on the required competencies of professionals. And, you know, as blockchain is essentially about how data and information is stored and distributed, obviously with many different applications, as Yolene has explained, obviously the security side is important. And, you know, Yolene has talked about trust and the need for a high level of trust, and also the fact that, you know, it's not just about blockchain, there are systems surrounding it as well, which can sometimes make it vulnerable if they're not as strong as the blockchain security itself. So, you know, from that perspective, I think blockchain already has particularly strong links with two Exyn certification programs, the data protection program and also the information security program. Obviously, organizations that are making use of blockchain technology in some way, they need to make sure that they're handling data and information in a secure way. And some of the role-based certifications within Exyn, such as, you know, the information security officer, the data protection officer, particularly professionals in these roles need to be very aware of both the opportunities, but also the risks involved in using blockchain technology and how to deal with those. So there's already quite a lot of links between the Exyn existing portfolio and blockchain. But in addition to that, we are also exploring, you know, the extent to which there may be a need for a separate certification program in the area of blockchain, or whether it's just a matter of linking to that from existing areas. Obviously, as blockchain does become a lot more the norm, or a lot more accepted, it could be that, there is a separate need for certification based on the need for additional competences in that. So we'd be interested to hear any feedback that you have on that as well. We recently did a survey also to that end to try and get feedback on how that's perceived. But, you can be assured in any case that we'll certainly be following this closely and adapting our portfolio accordingly.
Thank you very much, Suzanne, for this explanation. This helps. We've got another question. It's a more broad question for Jolien. It's for public blockchain networks, who will be responsible for governance?
That's a very interesting question that nobody has a good answer for yet, especially because the question is about public blockchains, because it hasn't been fully answered for either public or private. So if you look at Bitcoin, there is no one responsible for its governance. And you've seen that there's all kinds of parties and all kinds of debates going on around it. And there's the Bitcoin core developers, and there's the miners and the mining pools that are getting more and more power. So who's actually responsible? And if you want to read more about it, I talked about Don Tapscott in my in this webinar. He wrote a white paper that was given out by the World Economic Forum. I think it was 2017. And this white paper is about governance in the blockchain space. And what he talks about in the, or writes about in this white paper, is that he's worried about governance in the blockchain space, because if you can see a parallel between the development of the internet and the development of blockchain, where the internet is the first native medium for information, blockchain is the first native medium for digital medium for value. And then in the internet, the governance grew organically, but now there's a lot of problems in it. So you see these big companies that are buying and selling your data. They're already called the Frightful Five, the Amazons and Googles of this world. But then blockchain isn't only about information, it's about the exchange of value. So this is really a risk if we don't arrange governance in the right way. And then the question is, who should? Because blockchain does not really account for national borders, for example, because you can exchange value digitally with anyone around the world. So it's difficult for a national government to start thinking about the governance of blockchain solutions, because they don't really have the power to do that. And what Don Tapscott writes about is that we should really come up with a good governance structure for blockchain on three levels. It should be on the worldwide level, so more on the protocol level, then on the platform level. And there's all kinds of different technical platforms now, but how should they be governed? And on the level of the applications. So if one single application, and but even if you look at the business context, if there's four or five enterprises working together in a blockchain solution, how is governance arranged? Who owns the platform? Who's responsible if something goes wrong? So that's a very interesting thing that hasn't, there is no best practice yet. It still has to it has to develop, and I think we will find it out along the way as we go. Just because this is such a conceptually different thing than we already know, it's quite hard, and because it's not bound to national boundaries, it's quite hard to find out where it's going. Maybe also interesting in this light is Kasper Corius. He was at our VIN symposium this year. We have a symposium every year in June. And he has this vision about how we are moving in 10 steps towards a fully digitized government that doesn't have any geographic borders anymore. So Kaspar Korjus, he belongs to the government of Estonia. And already anybody around the world can become an Estonian citizen. I think you pay maybe 100 euros and then you're a citizen in Estonia and you can start a business there. So for maybe Europeans, it's less interesting, but if you're from Russia or from anywhere around the world, it can be economically very interesting to have a Estonian digital identity. And Kaspar Korjus, well, to round it up, Kaspar Korjus has this vision about how we are moving away from the combination of government and geographic location to governments that are fully digitized, and you choose yourself what kind of nation you belong to in a digital world.
Thank you very much. That's a great answer. I've got another question here. That's more over about the future. When do you expect that blockchain will be implemented within our lifestyle?
That's quite a difficult that's quite a difficult question. And also, I think that it's different for everybody personally, because there's already people that for whom this is reality, who have it in their lifestyle, who, for example, are investors in cryptocurrency and are trading every day, then it's already a part of your lifestyle. There's already bigger companies using blockchain to authenticate certifications, for example. So then it's already also part of daily life. And it's just, we can't predict the future. They say it's a rule of thumb that you always overestimate the developments in the next year and always underestimate how it will be in 5 years. I do have one extra slide that kind of illustrates this, how I think about it, at least. This is a quote by Doktorov. He's one of my favorite writers. And this quote for him is about writing a novel. But for me, it's about how you look at the future and how you're going forward toward the future. It's like driving a car at night. You never see further than your headlights, but you can make the whole trip that way. So we're just moving along and we can see a bit and we can see trends that are coming and trends, if they're here for a while, they'll probably also continue for a while. But to be sure, how this will exactly change our world and when this will be, I just don't know.
Okay, thank you very much. I think we have time for one more question. Is that okay?
Yeah, sure.
How can blockchain be leveraged in banking and insurance industries?
Well, that's a very broad question as well. I'll start with banking, because banking is quite a difficult one, because it's the classic example in payments of a third party that you wouldn't need anymore once you use cryptocurrencies. On the other hand, banks have a lot of complex financial products that could use blockchain in different ways. There's, for example, a few large banks, also from the Netherlands, that are building trade finance platforms to see if there could be, if that could be an interesting space for them. A lot of that is also still in experimentation stages. When you look at insurance, well, that's a different, I think, a different story. Also very interesting. You could look at claims automation, for example. A lot of claims handling is still done by people, but if you could automate these claims, and an interesting example is Lemonade. It's a company from New York, and they're growing quite fast, because what they do is they use a couple of new technologies in combination. Image recognition and blockchain are the main ones, and they pay out your claim in 3 seconds. Because you just talk to the to the camera, tell them my sunglasses were stolen, and they analyze your face to see if you're lying. And if their analysis shows you're not, then they immediately pay out your claim. And this whole claims handling, so to see what contracts do you as an individual have, what kind of policy do you have with them, what are the main characteristics of your claim, do this fit together, so do you have right to payment of this claim, that's all done through blockchain and smart contracts. So that's, I think, an interesting one. And also a similar combination goes for upcoming markets in agriculture, for example, because often insurers don't work there for crop insurance, for example, in Africa or similar countries. And if you can use satellite images to automatically spot who has right to what kind of claims, and if you can automate the full process of claims handling, then all you need is technology, and you can provide insurance for a much lower price to farmers who couldn't otherwise pay for insurance. So I think that's two examples in the insurance industry, but there's a lot more. It also depends on the kind of insurance, and well, you could talk for another half hour, I think, about use cases in insurance industry.
Okay, great. Well, we're coming at the end of the webinar. Thank you very much for answering all the questions, and also thank you for presenting, Jolien. I'd like to thank the audience for the attendance and also for the great questions. We will send you the recording at the end of this week, and there were a lot of questions about the links the books that Jolien talked about. We will send them all in this email, so you will have the information at hand. Thank you so much, and this is the end of the webinar. Bye.